Kathy died real suddenly from a brain aneurysm. She was 29 years old. There was no warning. Organ donation was a very painful decision to make on my own. I wish we'd talked about it, because I didn't know if I was doing the right thing. We didn't have that discussion because we thought we were young. We thought we had a lot of time, but we didn't.
Chemistry class led me to a life of crime. I catch murderers, rapists, and thieves with a microscope. Help your daughter become a scientist. Instead of a tea set, get her a chemistry set. Look at the boring job I got from being a science nerd. Expect the best from a girl. That's what you'll get.
Hi, welcome to Discussion Unlimited. I'm Dr. Ray Young, and what you're about to see is students in my Communication 408 class, that's small group communication, discussing issues of today. This assignment is meant to be a learning experience for the students to learn more about the facets of group communication. And for you, the audience, to listen and think about the different issues of today. So sit back and relax and enjoy Discussion Unlimited.
Seated directly to my left is Lee Owenby. She also is a senior public relations major here at Valdosta State. She is from Macon, Georgia. Seated next to her is Jonathan Godfrey, a senior organizational communications major from Tallahassee, Florida. And next to him is Clem Hill, a senior public relations major from Tifton, Georgia. These students will be on the side of anti-internet censorship. They will be on the side of pro-internet censorship. Seated directly to my right, I have Blair Johnston. He is a senior public relations major here at Valdosta State University. And next to him is Scott Seeley. He also is a senior public relations major here at Valdosta State University. Scott is from Stone Mountain, Georgia. These students will be anti-government censorship of the internet. The internet. In today's world, people have not only become used to this new technology, but we have embraced it and cannot imagine what our lives would be like without it. Whether communication through email or surfing the net for useful information, millions of people log on to a variety of internet carriers daily. Internet resources can help college students gather useful information for reports, businessmen and investors can gather up-to-the-minute stock dates, and people can purchase a variety of items from flowers to airline tickets, all without leaving the comfort of their home or offices. The concept of internet technology is not new, but only in the past few years has it become so popular. It is estimated that over 1 million people daily log on to the internet. However, there is a dark side to this technology. The internet is also a place that individuals can access pornographic information as well as violent information, such as how to create the perfect murder or how to formulate the perfect bomb. Parents and civil groups have also become aware of the dangers that lurk online. They have urged Congress to pass a series of acts that limit who can access what information while online. These laws have become known as the Communications Decency Act of 1996, or the CDA. What the Communications Decency Act itself does, it restricts minors from accessing materials online, it makes internet carriers themselves responsible for who accesses adult material, and it also protects individuals from receiving threatening or harassing information, be it via email or internet chat rooms. Although these laws were created to protect internet users, many feel that these laws violate citizens' constitutional right to free speech. The first question I would like to ask our panel today is, does the Communications Decency Act violate the First Amendment to the Constitution? Lee, do you have any comments on that?
Yes, Rob. There are several reasons that I feel that it does not violate our First Amendment right of free speech. First of all, because the CDA puts the choice of regulation into the hands of the community. They are the ones that will decide who is to regulate what's to be seen and so forth. And technically that is what our country was founded on. It was a democratic way of doing things, you know. We our electoral vote system is based on that. Secondly, the electronic media shouldn't be any different now than, say, print media or radio and television, which is all regulated by the FCC. They are a governing body that decides what is harmful for children, advertisements, and that kind of thing. And also there's the AMA, which is for the marketing regulations. And so no, I don't think, you know, it's about time we've got a governing system set up. And lastly, I'd like to point out something that's very important. This does not make it illegal for materials to be shown on the internet or anything like that. It simply restricts the children and people who shouldn't or don't want access to these sites. And as of now, many people are in different sites themselves are charging money to access these. And so, therefore, to me, that's not any different than having an ID being required to be shown at a 7-Eleven or, you know, when you buy beer or pornographic things. So, and lastly, I think without this would be a censorship of my freedom of speech, because I don't want a public medium bringing things into my home or my office that I feel are, you know, that are maybe, I guess, chancy to say, you know, I don't like them, and I don't want to see them, I don't want them in my home or my office, so.
Blair, do you have any comments you'd like to add?
Yes, to start, I'd like to state part of the First Amendment. It says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, or the right of the people to peaceably assemble and to petition the government for redress of grievances. I believe it is a violation of my First Amendment to, you know, to put a censorship on this internet. It's every person has the liberty to exchange information. There's the liberty to engage in the insights of one's fellow citizens, to vent, to schmooze, to make noise, publish stigmatized opinions, unmask hypocrisy, and even circulate gossip. I feel this is some of the liberties that we should be able to have the freedom of doing. And it's not just pornographers that are against this censorship. There's a lot of people, a lot of businesses, a lot of respected big businesses. American Booksellers Association, Apple, Microsoft, America Online, and several of these respectable businesses are against this censorship.
I've heard several internet carriers themselves have accessibility codes and whatnot that restrict minors from being online themselves. Now, is this issue actually true, or, I mean, how does this work in? How does this work in with the new CDA Act? I mean, is it tied in with that, or are you guys for this or against it?
You want to take that? I'll take that. There's America Online, I know, has a censorship program. They monitor the chat lines, and it should be, and that's part of what I believe. If there is to be any middle ground, it should be America. It should be the services that are regulating themselves and not the government.
Mm-hmm. Another great question that's been brought up often, is it actually the parents' responsibility, or should it be the U.S. government's responsibility to regulate the internet? Clem, you're a parent. Do you have any responses for this right now?
I believe in the First Amendment. I believe in it wholeheartedly, but I also believe in the other things like life, the pursuit of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. I believe in that too. And whenever I can't allow my kids like to go upstairs to be on the computer or the internet and take a chance on someone trying to, you know, communicate to them, or them learning from their, through peer pressure at school, attempting to get into access this pornographic material that's on there, you know, that infringes on my rights and my rights as a parent. In all honesty, there's no way for a parent to stand over a child constantly and monitor them while they're on these computers. It's just an impossibility.
I agree with that. Ray Bruner is an advocate of the CDA, and he has his own homepage, and he mentions in there, same thing, reiterating what Clem said, you can't expect a parent to monitor a child 24 hours a day, and it is an impossibility. Just the same way as a child cannot walk into 7-Eleven and buy pornographic material, although a child of any age, 10 and 12 year old children, can program a computer, they can't walk in 7-Eleven and buy those type of materials, but they can sit at home on the computer, be it their parents think they're doing their homework, and they're sitting there accessing pornographic material, and these people are swaying them towards it. You know, there's a line there. There's a difference between First Amendment rights and should a parent control it or the government. You know, parents can't control that when the child can access it freely. You know, there's got to be something there to regulate that.
Another thing I'm curious about right now, as an internet user myself, who is going to be expected to pick up the cost for the Communications Decency Act? Who's actually going to pay to make sure that it is censored online?
The American taxpayer. The government should not get involved whatsoever with this internet problem. The fact is that I'm going to have to pay for it, and I don't even own a computer. The government will just bite off too much, just more than they can chew. The internet has gone international. It's hard to get everybody to register as an adult. Anybody that can access any web page or any go on to any chat line, you know, that had to be a registration of them being an adult. I took the liberty and cruising around on the internet this afternoon, and all the ones that I came across that were pornographic or censorship worthy, all had parental warnings and advisories in the beginning of them. The government doesn't need to get involved.
But other than parental advisories right now, even with the Censorship Act in effect, is there any other restrictions right now to those pages? I mean, say I was an 8-year-old child accessing those pages, is there anything other than asking for a birthday that they're specifically looking for to keep me off of a restricted page? How effective is the act, in other words, is what I'm trying to get across to you?
The restricted page, I don't really understand what you're trying to say.
In other words, I'm an 8-year-old child, I'm accessing a page that I am not supposed to be on. Right now the government is stating that there's supposed to be a governorship by the internet provider themselves to make sure that someone who is not of age cannot access that material themselves. So in other words, if you went in there and if you could figure out a birth date or a code, or if you could hack around as you needed to online, could you figure out as a minor how to access pages that you shouldn't be there in the first place?
If the government was to come in and to put a limit on the pages, if they were to, let's say you had to punch in your social security number just to get the approval to get on the line, I have a feeling that an 8-year-old child can find their ways around that. There's really no stopping an 8-year-old child from getting into these pages. 8-year-old just being, it could be an 8-year-old, it could be a 14-year-old, it could be a 16-year-old. The parents are the one that's, I mean, that is your regulator right there. If you don't want this stuff in your home, get rid of your computer.
May I interject?
Who are you?
Seymour Smoke, smoke detector. And I see more smoke coming from that toaster.
Thanks for warning us, Seymour.
I hate smoke. So whenever I see it, I make this noise to warn you. Because where there's smoke, there may be fire.
Be cool about fire safety.
Be cool.
They want to get me, I'm going to be ready to get them.
They just shoot. They don't care who gets in the way.
I want to be respected. Just gets me respect, know what I'm saying?
I'm afraid to walk to school, okay?
Yeah, I might die. Everybody dies.
Kids shooting, kids getting shot. They're all victims of gun violence. The killing won't stop unless you help stop it. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT for free information. Not one more lost life. Not one more grieving family. Not one more.
I don't want to die.
Hi, Puddin.
Oh, you're so cute. I don't have shoes.
Oh, if you are gorgeous. Noreen, talk to me.
If you don't stop someone from driving drunk, who will?
Come on, talk to me.
Do whatever it takes.
Come on, you can do it.
May I interject?
Yes, you certainly may, Clem.
That's where tax incentives for these companies, if they will come up with ways to block that information, because as Scott stated, yeah, these 8-year-old kids are able to access this information. And that's where the problem lies. These companies need, by tax breaks or whatever it might be, give them a reason to come up with a solution for, you know, to keep these kids from accessing this information. That's the whole beef that I have with the system, the way it works right now.
Yeah, we interviewed Joe Newton, who is a webmaster here at VSU, and he mentioned that along with lines of what Clem's speaking about, there currently there are things that are being developed. One thing is called the net nanny, which would certainly weed out those particular pornographic materials or what have you, anything that would fall along those lines. And he mentioned that that would be the avenue to take, would be to make for the government to subsidize these companies and give them incentives to produce something such as this. And that would be what it would take, because, you know, the child, as Scott mentioned, can access an 8-year-old. However, if the kid can get on the computer, he can access any of these things, and naturally they can't be controlled. So there does need to be some type of incentive for these companies that are putting out the, you know, American Online and what have you, to promote this.
I also talked to Debbie Whalen, who is the vice president of EdPAC Communications, EdPAC Publishing rather, and she what that company basically does, it is a web page publisher, and they make web pages for other clients and things like that. And she has children, and basically she said, what we're saying, no, we can't expect the government to come in and totally regulate everything. That's impossible. We don't want that. But we would like to see the government taking some sort of responsibility. And she even mentioned the fact that maybe the internet could have standards, the government could set standards for the internet, the servers themselves, and possibly hold their clients responsible for the content that's found on their pages. And that's, you know, with the CDA, if there's a trial that goes to court, or, you know, or something like that, if these servers are saying that, you know, hey, we're going to be held liable if we allow children access to these pages, or if we don't, then, you know, then they're liable to be more restrictive, and thus, you know, kind of self-regulate their own industry without involving the government, or without, you know. And even getting back to what Jonathan said about having subsidized, you know, programs, the programs that are available now, like the Net Nanny, they have to be redone, you know, every so often, because they're constantly changing sites on the net, you know, and the program information itself is getting, you know, is going to change. And I think I don't agree with the fact that, you know, our parents and our country as a whole, if we're trying to help ourselves become more, you know, information wise, that we're subjecting ourselves to this. And with, you know, it's a public medium, I don't, you know, that's the only way that we can really see the government stepping in and helping, because otherwise it's just so vast and so big that it would be.
I'm just curious to get a different light on this matter. Blair, what are your feelings on such things as Net Nanny and other governor items that they have out of shareware right now that help regulate the internet itself?
Well, I feel that, I mean, if there's to be a medium, that should be what we should use. I have a quote here from Jonah Seeger from the Center for Democracy and Technology. It says, if we're serious about protecting our children, we wouldn't be ignoring the filtering technology like SurfWatch, which is similar to the nanny, that's available to all parents, and trying to pretend that the net isn't a global medium. In other words, I mean, they are making an effort right now to self-regulate, but, I mean, it's going to be up to the parents to step up and do this. And another quote he has, it's ironic to me that pro-family activists would declare that the federal government is a better judge of what their children should see than the American parents are, which I feel. I think the parent, you know, if the parents don't like what the kids are seeing on the internet or have no idea, you know, then you take the computers out of the rooms.
Well, you can't go to the library and access books on Playboy and Penthouse. I mean, this is a public medium that's coming into our homes. And Clem, I think you were.
The way I see it, we're addressing our government as our enemy. Our government is, you know, it shouldn't be addressed that way. I detect that in everybody's tone, the way we're addressing this. Our government is we the people of the United States of America. And we the people, what we have to do, if we're so interested in, you know, protecting our children from being exposed to this pornographic material, what we should do is we should take and file petitions, write to our congressmen, do whatever it takes to get the message across that we don't want that garbage online for our kids to get to. It's us, our government's not our enemy. It might seem like it's in the past few years that's the general trend, but they're not, and we're the ones that are supposed to motivate them to do what we want as citizens of this country.
Well, up until the CDA, basically every telecommunication industry was regulated, and with the internet being an up and coming new industry, I think there does need to be new legislation, and that is exactly what the CDA represents. I mean, you know, everything else is regulated. Why not the internet?
Something to add on Lee's. She said that you can go in the library and access pornographic material in there. Clem, I understand you also have small children and you're worried about the internet, and a lot of schools use computers and internet services. I've spoken with small business owners, computer business owners, Chuck Yarbrough, one Delta South Communications president. I asked him what his opinion on regulating the internet, and he said it'd be massive devastation because you'd lose so much information, art, literature, because somebody out there would find something that was pornographic about it.
I was saying you can't go to the library and check out like Playboy or something. But actually, now that the schools are getting online, if you know, as Jonathan had said earlier, you can't expect to be with your child 24 hours a day, and so they're in their library at school, and they, you know, happen across this page. Kids, being curious as they are, they're going to go, oh well, you know, hey, you know, and tell their little friends about it, and you know, nobody's even going to be aware of what they're doing until later on, which, you know, we aren't even aware of the fact of what this age and information and technology is going to do to our children years down the road, the access, allowing them the access to this kind of material. I think Clem had a point about...
Well, Dr. James Dobson from Focus on the Family, he had an interview. I'm sure everyone remembers Ted Bundy. He's very infamous. He interviewed Ted Bundy just hours before he was executed, and Ted Bundy, he accredited a lot of these perverted ideas and thoughts that he had to his exposure to pornographic material. And from everything that I've read and I understand, he came from a Christian background. His family, they didn't allow him. They tried to do everything they could in their power to keep their children from being exposed to this material. But through peer pressure and, you know, and obviously his own problems that the man suffered, you know, this added to it, and he accredited his exposure to pornographic material and the exposure to a lot of other criminals that he was exposed to in prison. They accredited pornographic material that they were exposed to as children, you know, while they were being in during their formative years as children, they were exposed to this, and it created a lot of perverted ideas in their minds and all, and it set them down the road to where they wound up eventually.
Well, thanks, Clem. I appreciate your comments there. At this time, I would invite audience members to ask questions to our panelists. Please, when you're addressing your questions, make sure you ask a specific panel member what they would like or what would you like to have answered.
Scott and Blair, if y'all are against censorship, would y'all feel comfortable having your children seeing naked people on the internet?
I'll answer that. My child won't be looking at that because I'll be monitoring them.
24 hours a day, you'll monitor them?
Yes, I'll take the computer with me.
Okay.
Well spoken. Thank you.
Any other questions from the audience? Yes, Dr. Young, you look like you're chomping at the bit back there.
I'd like to make another comment, Rob.
Certainly.
In lieu of what Clem was mentioning about Ted Bundy, it just, you wonder in your mind who maybe could be the next Ted Bundy out there. What child could be accessing this pornographic material? I mean, it could be the next Ted Bundy that is swayed or being influenced by the internet. And you never know. That's why I feel like there does have to be some type of regulation. And
I think one thing before the next question, I think what it boils down to is that, I mean, conversations between adults are going to become illegal. Books will become illegal. I mean, over the internet.
The
art will become illegal. Stuff
right.
Like that. Because what about David's... Michelangelo's David, the statue, that's a piece of art. It's a statue of a naked man, but it may be seen as obscene.
The CDA is being voted on. What is being regulated is voted on by our communities themselves. I mean, this is democratic. This is the way our country was founded. You know, we have established precedents of what is art. The New York, I believe it was one of the art galleries in New York, censored itself. And so from distinguishing what is art and what is not. And the email, as far as that goes, that is not, it's whatever is threatening, harassing, things like that, or what is going to be protected. You know, you're going to be protected, not censored, you know, from receiving threatening things. So.
Let me wrap this up with one last audience question here.
Yeah, I wanted to dedicate this, or ask it to Scott. What about computers putting a block on like pornographic material? Aren't they doing that now?
From what I understand, there are blocks. You have to have special codes to get into, right, and stuff like that. I ran across many of them that were like that.
So you can childproof your computer, basically, right? You can childproof your computer.
Yeah.
Going back to what Joe Newton said, these encryption codes don't last. The child can figure out ways around them, and it's just. And plus, going back to what y'all said earlier, the internet is so advanced and so vast that there's no way we're going to be able to crypt out every single thing. So.
Again, I would like to thank our panelists this afternoon and our audience as well. And this has been Discussion Unlimited.
You have to say
the power of teaching.
They're the ones who's coming up, and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children, teach them the very best you can. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. Na, na, na,
na, na, the power to wake up young minds, the power to wake up the world. Teachers have that power. Reach for it.
Just you and
teach.
Me. Wake up all the teachers. Time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen.
Reach for the power. Teach. I'm Edward James Olmos, and we're recruiting new teachers. For information, call 1-800-45-TEACH.
When you teach the children.
Picasso painted The Old Guitarist during a period of depression that lasted 4 years, his blue period. Today, with new discoveries, 80% of depressive disorders are being successfully treated, giving hope to millions that maybe now nobody has to have a blue period.
Math, a four-letter word, right? Hey, you don't need that.
Why design the world's newest chips?
When you could be flipping the world's oldest burgers. Hey, wait a minute. This is math. Geometry, algebra.
No pocket protectors here.
But you're cruising without math.
Yeah, right.
Take a good look.
That's math staring back at you.
It's not a problem, man. It's an answer. Call NACME. We'll tell you what you need to do.